Okay, welcome back to our final sort of session where we have all our speakers here with us again on stage. I'd like to introduce an additional person here on stage. Her name is Amrita Mukarji, and she's from the Sutra Textile Studies, which is a not-for-profit society established in Kolkata in 2002. And she's joining us here today as a respondent to today's proceeding. Yeah. You know, we've heard four of our really sort of four very different sort of like papers and very different researchers and on very different sort of topics. I was wondering if you have any thoughts you want to share about, you know, what our speakers have sort of shared with us today. Do you want to sort of start with that? You just have to speak into it. This way.
This way.
Yes.
Well, first of all, thank you very much, all of you, because I learned such a lot today from all of your talks. And I think, should I say a thank you on behalf of all of us who attended? From Supriya, can you hear me?
Yeah.
From Supriya, of course, there was a lot that has happened in Shantiniketan and with Rabindranath Tagore that, again, some of it maybe I knew through her work, but there was a lot that was not known to me, and it was very enlightening. And also I feel that, coming here, and just before that, looking at batik in India, it's, I would say, a start in some new research in what is happening today. And also what has happened in the past, that there is a lot to document. With Maria. Okay, I think that's a good idea. In fact, there were two pictures that you were shown, one of a lady who is practicing batik now, as it is. It is not as refined as what was being done, but it is more in the tradition of that style. And in the marketplace where we went and looked at the textiles, we found that somebody was recreating batik, inspired by older styles, but in a new style, yes. So we could show that and you can have a visual look at it, which is always very nice. This is by the lady and her granddaughter, the picture that was shown of the lady. And this is more or less in the style that it was being done. But it is, to our eyes, not as refined as what we used to get before. Are very much inspired by the Ajanta and Ellora, Ajanta paintings in India. And I think when batik started in Shantiniketan, it was, as Supriya mentioned, from another tradition called Alpona, which is designs made on the floor with rice flour. And we just visited an exhibition of Alpona in Shantiniketan before I came. And it was, I saw a lot of the designs there as designs that had been adapted for batik design in Shantiniketan. Supriya mentioned the marketplace that we went to, which is actually inside a wood. And it's beautiful, atmospheric, and you know, people just sit on the floor, put out their mats, and put up their wares. And this is what we found there.
We'll find out later. Sorry, how much does it cost in rupees? 4,200 rupees. So, does anyone know the conversion rate? 4,200 rupees. Okay. Anyway, okay. Should we continue? Yes. Do you have any comments on the rest of the speakers? Do you want to sort of continue sort of reflecting on some of the presentations today?
No, I was very excited to hear about the Queen's Syndicate Museum because this is a very personal thing, but I've been to Thailand several times and I've tried to visit the museum to see I'm very interested in traded textiles. And I know that the museum has quite a few. And
Wait, I have to speak here.
Okay. No, I've been very interested, actually, apart from the museum, in your topic where Queen Sirikit has been so instrumental in helping the weaving communities and the textile communities. And that I've sort of seen from a very long time. You know, I think I first visited Thailand in probably 1977, 78. I can't remember. Yes. Yes. So that interested me very much. That and I've always been interested in the fact that Queen Sirikit has been so instrumental in developing the textiles in Thailand. But apart from that, the Queen Sirikit Museum, I'm very interested in seeing for the traded textiles of India, which had been there. So, and you know, I'll talk to you about it later. But I'm, again, the Pua Kumbu also has been of great interest to me. I have several pieces of Pua Kumbu, which I must have picked up in 1999 or 2000. But my first sort of, the first time I saw Pua Kumbu was in Kuala Lumpur, in again, the when I was here, I left Malaysia in 1993. So it was before that. There was an Australian, there was an exhibition at the Australian High Court. Yes. That's where I first saw it. And when you were talking about traditions that are no longer there and which would probably kill the art, I was thinking about, I have actually been to Sarawak and been to the longhouse and seen Pua Kumbu being made and a white cockerel being slaughtered just before that. Yes. So I can understand, you know, what you're saying, and it's a great thing that, you know, you are keeping it alive. It's so important. It's something that I'm, we have an organization called Sutra, as Simon mentioned, and it is about awareness of our textile heritage. But I think the awareness has to lead on to something more. It is because we want to keep our traditions alive, weavers, you know, going, that this is necessary. And I had a lot to learn from that. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. I guess what's interesting for me today is that despite the range of methodologies that are employed by our speakers today, you know, we have an anthropologist, a cultural historian, you know, someone who approaches the subject of textile from art history and from various other sort of like different disciplines. The fact remains that you're all trying to sort of think outside of the national as a kind of framework, you know, trying to think of how textile is, as what you call, what Maria sort of, the term you used just now was, you call it liquid modernity, that it's part of a very fluid sort of like, pattern of circulation, right? That is quite global in character, so that it's not so fixed to a sort of national kind of like framework. Yeah, I was wondering if any one of you would sort of like want to continue to comment on that. I think Supriya, you mentioned yesterday on radio when we went on BFM that this borrowing that Tagore had, he was very promiscuous. He wasn't sort of fixed on this idea of India needing to sort of follow a very particular style or particular form of art, but he sort of borrowed very casually from all over the world in order to reinvent local tradition.
You always believed in borrowing, and also that mankind shared a common heritage which was open to all. So he borrowed freely himself, and he encouraged others also to share whatever we had or whatever we wanted to.
Can you tell us a bit about the debates between him that he had with, say, Gandhi, for example? Because Gandhi was, he was quite a nationalist on many levels.
Yeah. Subject, Gandhi was very open.
Okay.
In fact, he used to say that we must have all our windows open and let the breeze from all countries come in. We should only be careful that we're not blown off our feet. That's all. So actually, in this perspective, they shared this thing of allowing other cultures to influence us, or we should take the best from everyone. So in on this subject, they agreed.
So what was
so
the
they argument? Disagreed on many subjects, but on this particular one, they agreed.
But, sorry, I mean, this is again coming. What I'm going to say, or what I have said, is probably all of my personal experiences. And I realize I didn't even talk about Maria's you know, paper, which was again, fascinating. That's right. I feel my presence here is, or I feel very connected to all of our speakers here because of our textile sort of adventures. And one of them was, you know, we lived in Malaysia for about 11 years, after which we went to Africa. I was very excited to go there, but I felt that I wasn't connected to Africa. We went to Nigeria. And the very first day I was there, I felt totally connected by, you won't believe it, batik. Because, I mean, I saw the majority of the population there wearing batik prints, which is what Maria spoke about. And later, of course, I found out they were real wax, which wasn't either real, neither was it wax. But they were all batik prints.
I've got two. Should we sort of like, are there any questions from the floor? You know, any questions that you've been sort of keeping that you wanted to ask our speakers? Yeah. Do you mind sort of heading over to the microphone and?
This is directed at Welyne. Welyne, you mentioned that, I mean, we saw from the video that all the weavers are very wise. Okay. And I'm sort of wondering what is done about the younger weavers.
Because we are in our missions to harvest young weavers. When I say wise, you know what I mean by wise, but when I say younger weavers, it's not about children or teenagers. Younger weavers mean any woman who are trying, any men and women who are willing to learn. So in fact, 3 years ago, in this project, we only had one very young weaver, young in the sense that she just started to learn and she was 15. But after 3 years now, we have about 25 young weavers of different ages, and our youngest weaver is 65 years old in terms of skill. She has never been weaving at her longhouse, as nobody has any knowledge about this weaving in her longhouse. And her longhouse is just about 3 hours by express boat from this longhouse. Yeah, it's quite a long journey, but it's amazing how it happened that 3 hours down the river, there is totally no river at all, you know? And you would only find these weavers deep in the forest. And we are having a program now, and I'm introducing some workshop for the local longhouses around Kapit area and also in Kuching, all over Sarawak, that we are proposing if they would like to be introduced to Puak Kumbu, just a general ideas information. So we are organizing tours, some 1 week. If they like it, they can stay for as long as they want. In fact, we do have people who have been living there. Every time she comes, she will stay for 1 month just to learn to weave, to learn about natural dye, and to learn the correct way of weaving Puak Kumbu, because there are certain longhouses, they do weave Puak Kumbu, but they are using chemical dye. And and they do not know the story and the name of the motif. So we make it as a one-stop learning center, the longhouse where I did my research, and all the weavers, they are willing to take new interns. We even have interns coming from Belgium, and she's coming in 2 months to stay for 6 months. So there are people around the world who actually ask to learn weaving there, but there are so few requests from our local people, you know, because they said that we can't spend so much time living at the longhouse. So I said, how can it be that people from overseas, thousands of kilometers, can come for 2 weeks, 1 month? I think it's also about attitude, how we see the importance of our tradition, because most of the time, foreigners would be very so interested in this kind of traditions, you know, and us local take it for granted. So we try to kind of create awareness as well, you know, about the intangible cultural heritage and how important this knowledge is in order to continue with the identity of the community. Yes. I hope that answers.
Hi, I'm Yuan Mei Wong, a Malaysian, but I taught women, arts and culture in University of Maryland in USA. So in the United States context, fabric is a very important material culture for women's experience, especially tapestry in the United States has been used as a site for women to tell stories. And by collecting this material and also tracing the history, we are able to trace a very rich history of the women in the society and in history. So I have a question for all of you, you know, because you are doing research in different locality on the same medium, batik, and so happen all of you are women researchers. So I wonder from your research, did you find actually batik also a very important site for women's expressions? And it documents their struggles, experiences, and compared to the contemporary women who are still weaving batiks, or not weaving and making batiks, or weaving poa kompu, do they actually express themselves differently? And they talk about different stories, and things that are important to them actually might not be things that are important to their the grandmothers or the women before them. Thank you.
Great question. Anyone want to start?
In the research, at first, I actually focusing on women empowerment from the grassroots level and how they strive to become independent and to generate income. And the purpose I was looking at the poor Kumu weavers in the beginning of this research back in 2012 was because I was fascinated by their passions to earn income. And they way past to become employee to anybody, and no banks would give them any credits, and no government project would choose them to have certain kind of government projects. So I was thinking, okay, let's try to see what they can do. So in fact, I did not go to this particular longhouse back in 2012. I was in other longhouses. So the only thing that attracted me to these people was that they have this kind of skill which within them, and they have these natural resources surrounded them at the longhouse, and they don't even have to pay money to buy all these natural resources. All they need is to have access to yarn. So to have access to yarn, it is not impossible, because at the time we have some kind of research funding we can put aside as capital pool, and also there are some other weavers who are willing to put aside some of this having as well. So we recorded their struggles, their perceptions of why they are still doing this despite no money to buy yarn, and it's not function anymore in their daily life. Why do they still weave this even though now they're Christians, because all the sacred cloth was used in their traditional religion for wedding, for birth, for funerals, you know, for rituals, for all the 45 different rituals that they have to conduct the whole year. So I asked them, why do you still do this? It's passion. We would like to still to do this because it reminds us of our grandmothers, you know, we miss our grandmothers, we used to sit with them. So they have a very different stories why they continue this. But I also interview those women who are weaving kuakumbo in town area. Their stories and struggle are different. They are doing it totally for commercialization. They were using chemical dye and they sell it for 75 ringgit, you know, and then those people who weave it for passion, they don't even sell it. You come to their long house, they give it as a gift. And I felt guilty because I've been collecting a lot of kuakumbo when they give as a gift. So until I found the other long house who was saying, please help us because we have a lot of kuakumbo but we do not know where to sell. It's not like we want to sell them, but we do need money to go to the hospital. Our grandchildren wants to go to college, some wants to go to university, but as grandmothers, we would like to give them something, you know? And then I say, okay, come, let's try to sell. So they have many different stories, and the way they weave are also very different. So some weave for the purpose of commercialization, some weave for passion, but then they, especially when they see that tsunami started to come in, they are very excited to weave because they know that their passion can actually help their families. So, that part of the research on women empowerment was really successful, and I will still continue with it. And I actually shared this passion with one of the audience here, Shasha, I hope you said Sasi. Yes, because the struggles of the women that we are looking at, we are not just looking at the art and what they weave, the tradition, but actually the woman itself is the essence of the research and also the continuation of the tradition. Because like, I'm not a feminist, but you know, there is one of the feminist belief that woman is the guardian of the tradition, the intangible cultural knowledge, not us researchers, not us academics who publish books, you know. So, but they are not aware of their importance. So this is part of the things that we are trying to do in this research as well. So when we met them, very important, they started to tell the stories to their grandchildren. And when the grandchildren started to listen to their stories, they started to become very interested. And that's how it all began, you know. And I hope it will never end.
Batik, the stories are very different. When Shantiniketan Batik started, it was actually taken up by women, mainly women, who were already artists. So for them it was a new kind of art and it became kind of a passion for them. But today, I don't think there is any romantic connection. The only thing is they're doing it for me. It's just to eke out a living. There are some people who, for them, it is the only way of survival. So it is more for the economic reasons than anything else. And there are the government, there are some societies and some institutions that help them. They help them with cloth, with dyes, but not an assured market. So there are problems. Nothing really, very much to say about this.
For my part, I think I can't speaking about the weavers in relation to the Queen's Rigids Support Foundation. Back in the day, Thai weavers, obviously, it's mostly female member of the family who will weave for the fabric or the textile for the household to wear in the ceremonies, in the rituals, not for the commercialization or for a commodity. But when the queens try to support them, because when it's like tradition and elsewhere that within the generation it dies down. So the queens realize that this beautiful, this heritage of Thai textile should be preserved. So she become the supporter by providing materials or ready market for the weaver in the rural areas to produce their textile and Thai silk for the market and help the public to realize how worthy of, how worth of the textile, Thai textile in the market that is that it should be. So in a way, it's not like it doesn't convey with the female agency in terms of, you know, romanticization of femininity or feminism as much as we would like to think. I don't know, it's like we like to think of, but it's part of the household and then it becomes an industrial, maybe it's a mini industrialization in this modern world, because it becomes a souvenir for tourists, for travelers to see and to admire, and then it can be part of, as the Queen's has been done for over half a century, become a national identity by contribute the Thai textiles to the national dress. Hopefully this answer your question for some aspects. Thank you.
I would like to make some comments as regards Jevan's batik production and the process of making batik has undergone significant changes since the introduction of synthetic dyes. With natural dyes, which were used in the past, and occasionally there is a revival in natural dyes in Central Java, there was a very clear demarcation. Wax application was usually women's work, while dyeing with natural dyes was men's job. And there were specialized men who had the knowledge of dyeing with indigo, with soga, and usually this kind of work, dyeing, was outsourced. The waxing was done in batik workshops, and then the cloth would be sent to a specialized dyer who knew exactly what, how to reach particular type of hue and so on. With introduction of synthetic dyes, this has changed, and usually, because this is much faster, much simpler process, this process of dyeing is done usually at home, and it is in the hands of women nowadays. So batik, which in the past, I would say, was a little bit more like an outcome of a work of both genders, although men, I would say, very often they were not here acknowledged for their input and knowledge. Nowadays, usually it is just women work. And in principle, the problem with batik we have is that this is, well, too often this kind of a romantic perception is used in assessing this fabric. And actually, the work is very difficult and dangerous at times, and sometimes it is conducted in conditions which are less than perfect. And although the women who apply wax, they are very often exploited, they are paid very little, you have to remember that if we are looking at one piece of batik coming from Indonesia, this is usually an outcome of a work of several persons, at least five. And even with wax designs, those finer ones, there are two or three different women who apply different parts of a wax to the cloth, because sometimes the specialization is so narrow. For example, in the Chinese Uisu Chun workshop, there's one woman who specializes just in putting tiny dots of wax. She does nothing but just those tiny dots of wax. That's her job. So usually several women are employed in applying wax, and also dyeing is not usually done at home, but the conditions are really pretty poor. And although in recent years Indonesian government has introduced quite a lot of regulations to control the safety of a place, to improve workplace standards, but it's not always applied. Those places sometimes are very poorly lit, ventilated. There are a lot of wax fumes, very hot. And sometimes I really wonder why those women do. Why do they bother? This is such a laborious, time-consuming work. The fabrics are beautiful, this is true. But they are not much paid for it. And this work is really quite dangerous, and I'm not sure it's giving them much satisfaction. In the past, though, and I'm talking here about 19th century, approximately in the middle of the 19th century, batik, very often, especially on the northern coast of Java, used to be run, batik workshop used to be run by women from mixed marriages. Those were usually Dutch, Javanese, Javanese, Chinese, and so on. And it was well accepted socially that those women would be batik owners, they would organize the whole work. And it was making batik for those women, it was a very good business and empowerment, actually. But nowadays, it's still in Indonesia, women are still very frequently in charge of batik workshops. It's well recognized that this is women work, but it could well be also men's work. Just when it comes to wax application, usually this is given to women. And as I said, well, sometimes if I'm buying a good piece of batik and I look how much work went into it, I feel like paying double, to be honest. I think that they should be paid more. Just I'm not sure whether it would go to those women who do the hardest work, simply. But, well, I just wonder whether in the future there will be many women prepared to spend so many hours on such a laborious work as drawing those very fine wax designs and not being paid much for it. That's my experience. Thank you.
I have one more. Aspect of the support foundation, because it's become a foundation. So it's not just one institution in the big picture is the support foundation, but actually in each region, the queens also established the center for the members, but mostly it's female members to produce or to weave and to make a textile. So it's become a community, but in the same time, it brings the women to outside of their household and become more public, produce in the public sphere. So and they can communicate with other members. So in a way, it's open world to women. In the rural areas, more than the in the past that they just weave in their own household. I think this is the other side of this support foundation that promote and support the women in the society as well.
Do we have any more questions? Yes, please.
Hi, I run a social enterprise called Earth Air, working with craftspeople in Malaysia and a couple of other countries. My question is how, I mean, in working with artisans and working with craft-based businesses and cultures, how do you balance preserving heritage? And I think you've touched a little bit on, you know, financial sustainability, because without that, A lot of the times, the cultures don't get preserved when the artisans cannot actually live off of them. So I'd like to hear from the panel of your thoughts on that.
I don't know. Perhaps, you know, seminars, like the Sutra had a very good as a seminar on seminar workshop on batik. So sort of workshops and things could encourage the young, because of late young people they don't want to go into I'm concentrating on batik because I'm not a textile person at all. So but I feel that interest is going, it's time consuming, and if the person is an artist and has artistic abilities, he or she would rather use it for something else. Somehow, for reasons not known, perhaps it is too laborious for the amount of money that they get out of it.
it doesn't seem to be worthwhile.
And what people are willing to pay.
So a strong demand is necessary. If people want good quality batik, and if the demand is there, perhaps there might be a way out. But also, there are some organizations in Shantiniketan, as far as I know, where they do help. They help with people who are really interested. But I remember talking to one lady who was, she was willing to teach anyone. She said, I keep telling the young children who are in Kala Bhavan to come to me and I will teach them how to do it. Said they would come and they would get so impatient after a while, they wouldn't sit and, you know, take time to do this. So I really don't know how to go about this.
This has been a question which has worried us a lot. Because there are so many traditions that are dying, will die if action isn't taken very soon. I'll just talk about a couple of traditions that we have in Bengal. One is weaving. Bengal used to weave the finest sort of muslins and cottons, and this has been there for like millennia. And now the scenario is such that weaving families are just dying because becoming fewer and fewer because it is, it again gets down to economics. That they're not probably getting what they should be getting. And so children from these families are going out into more lucrative jobs. I've spoken to quite a few weavers and also people who work with them. There are a lot of designers who are working with them. So these weavers seem to be thriving, seem to be doing well. We are getting excellent quality weavings that are coming out of these places. But on the other hand, there are others that are not. And this is a question that has been on our minds for some time, and we are looking for ways to help. The other question that was put earlier about women and their traditions is that the other tradition in Bengal is Katha. Katha is actually embroidery, stitching. And yes, originally it was stitching of cotton quilts. These, it's a very hot climate. We wear cotton saris the year around. And when these become slightly frayed or old, these saris are taken, and quilted together with stitching, the basic running stitch. But up to a point, the women had time on their hands. This is even, say, 70, 80 years ago. And they would sit in the afternoons and then they would quilt these kathas, and they would design beautiful, designs from their minds. I mean, this was like art, quilt art, really. And we have we have collections of them in museums, which are really worth looking at. But today, although the skill is there, people don't have the time to do this. So they won't do it unless it is for selling, they earn out of it. And there is a lot of katha going, but these are designs given to them and they do the quilting, they do the work. There is, yes.
It is still alive and thriving.
And
isn't it, huh?
That's right, there is. And I think this is it. I think if we create the demand for it, if we make it lucrative for them and sustainable, that I think is what is needed. So this is actually a debate that has to be carried on and solutions found.
For the poor Kumbu, since there are no other social enterprises who are doing marketing, distributing, promoting, you know, unless there are patrons and also individuals who commission the weavers to weave the yarn. As much as I don't really like them, but I have to like them because they were the one who actually kept the tradition alive, even though the weavers have not been able to weave their own designs, but at least they are still keeping the traditions of using natural dye and the weaving style and still using backstrap loom. And none of the weavers are actually willing to move into flying shuttle loom and also any other loom. They were even being trying to introduce to songket loom. So the whole reason why they said they wouldn't shift to the other loom because they would like to keep it traditional. So as much as they have been manipulated by middle person who commissioned them to weave, they still weave out of passion. So like I said in my presentation, we try to have this social enterprise whereby we try to give authorities to the weavers to have a full management of the designs that they want to weave. But we try to get some capital pool, and of course we cannot approach investors because investors will squeeze them. And as you know that these productions need between at least 3 to 6 months to produce 4 pieces. And if we would have investors were just looking at profits. They want mass productions. And mass productions is not possible. So there are so many different things that we have to weigh. And also if we have been okay, I have been approached by so many investors, even from the US. So I said, you want to give me that much of money, I'm sure you are expecting a lot of profits. Expecting a lot of profits means mass productions. I was also approached by IKEA for some seasonal, you know, productions. But I have to say no. Because looking at all my weavers, they are very wise. You know, sometimes they just fall sick and stay in the hospital for 2 weeks. I used to have about 25 pieces orders from Costa Rica. I promise the customers, I said, you have to give me between 3 to 6 months. And she asked me why. Because my weavers are not young. You know, sometimes they fall sick and they can't weave. And if there's funeral at the longhouse, they are not allowed to weave. So finally, the 3 to 6 months order become 1 year. So it can be sustainable, but it also cannot be sustained. In the sense that it takes the whole aspect, elements of the cultural, the person itself who weave, in order to really make it as a sustainable source of income. So what we are targeting is to sell something very unique, high market, but not too expensive, affordable by everybody. So we are going to work with this other designer who actually just sent me a pair of shoes, a bag and a clutch, but the shoes was 2,800 ringgit. And I said, who would buy this? You know? He said, yeah, we have clients, a lot of clients who can afford this. I said, tell me how many. Because if you use just a small piece, I have about 35 weavers. How are they going to produce such small piece? And how many clients call the weavers who will buy this product and who will produce? You know, it's not a balance demand and also productions. If you use just a small piece for shoes, 2008, how about the other 34 weavers? So it's a bit hard to work with designers as well, because their product is very expensive and normal people like us can't access this product. So we are still trying to look for real designers with a big heart who can actually produce something that is affordable by everybody so that weavers can continue to produce in their own capable time and way, but at the same time they continue to weave and this thing continue to be produced. And in that sense, the tradition continues, young people see that there is income potential, they will start to learn, because not everybody can go to university, no? There are dropouts from school. So we are targeting the dropout from school to understand that this thing is doable. It can give you employment. And we do actually have a few weavers last year. One weaver was actually earning 8,000 ringgit in December. She is like a machine, you know, like, but we do not have a lot of weavers like her. She's the only one. Every time she give me something, I put up it sold out. She is the model of all other weavers. So I always take her as an example, said, look, she never stopped working. She look at every detail. So the quality also counts, I said. If you keep on sending me things, but nobody buys, I said. I do have a pork combo that I have been keeping for 2-3 years. Every time I put it out there, people just, you know, people don't look at it. So these are the pork combo that I sent to handbag makers. In fact, there are a few handbags that I advertise on Facebook. Now I have like 20, 30 orders for the same handbags. But it was the pork that I put in front of them 2 years ago. They never look at it. So certain of these like ugly pork combo design and ugly colors, when you turn it into other product, it becomes so beautiful. And people like, it's mine, everybody say it's mine, I want to buy it, you know? So it's a matter of strategizing how you want to present the textile as well, like make it clutches, handbags. I'm very impressed with what they do in Thailand and also in Manila, in the Philippines, like all their textile becomes something you can buy, you know? And so I learned from them. In fact, we have clutches, we have handbags, now we are producing neckties, the blue, red neckties. In fact, it's almost sold out. I got 150 pieces, now I only have 25 pieces left within a month. So it works, you know? If you diversify the products from the textile, and textile is just is a raw material, and you need to have another end products. That's how it can be sustained, I think.
Anyone have any other question? Okay. Oh, okay.
Just an observation that, you know, the Thailand model, if we could call it that, you know, Queen Sirikit being the patron or the patroness of the arts, somebody who is in that position, who is looked up and respected, and she uses her own textiles. That is one way that we can, you know, bring that awareness to the people.
If I may, I would like to add something else. That was Thai model, but we also have a Japanese model where the best craftsmen, they receive a title of living treasures. And they also get a lot of support from the government. I'm not sure whether such a term, or Korea, South Korea is also using this system of living treasures, rewarding the best craftsmen for their skill. But I'm not sure whether it's been introduced to Southeast Asia, this model of support, and whether it worked, whether it would be suitable in this society. But it seems that it works quite well in Japanese and South Korea, creates a lot of pride in the work that people do, a lot of acknowledgement, and it seems that they have no problem with finding the buyers for their goods. So.
Okay, in Malaysia, in fact, our master weaver, who is now with me at the gallery, she is the Adi Guru, or master weavers recognized by the National Craft. And her work is hanging at the UN headquarters, and she has a lot of recognitions from her work. However, she doesn't get any help. She has just been recognized as she is, you know. But National Craft, I do not want to criticize National Craft or or Sarawak craft for that matters, you know. But I think in Malaysia, living cultural heritage person is just because she's alive. Okay, that's my criticism. She doesn't, sorry, just because she is alive, it's true. Because she doesn't get any recognition. Yeah, she cannot attract any buyers to buy her puak kumbu unless I said, look, this is the puak kumbu by the master weavers, recognize here this, you know, she has traveled everywhere and this is from her dream. Unless I do added values, then people start to find her. I wish I do not have to do that. I wish that National Craft do that for her, and I wish whoever who give that recognition to her do that for her, you know, because she's still alive and she can actually help a lot of other young weavers. And in fact, we have two. We also have the other one who is still alive, living cultural heritage. Yeah, cultural heritage. So that's why she's still alive, but you are not using it. It's like you put artifact somewhere and kept it. You just have a look, but you're not trying to understand it. So this is the problem in Malaysia, I think. You know, you do have this recognition, but you don't really fully utilize it. And through our research, actually, I approached the some people at the Ministry of Education and also the Human Resource. I was asking, what procedure can we refer to if I would like to certify our master weavers to be qualified to teach at some curriculum activities at the university in schools? Because public university in Malaysia, they do have this extra core curriculum for the students. They are learning fine arts. They are learning to do something which is not local cultural heritage. I say, why would they learn to do something else other than our own cultural heritage? Because we are so rich. We have the batik, we have the songket, we have the puak kumbu, we have the carving, mahmeri, orang asli. Why would they go and learn something which is so foreign, you know? So the only answer was because our artisans do not have such recognition and they do not have a platform to showcase their skill, their art to this higher learning institution where it's very important. Even at school, they are not invited. So hopefully next year that I will work with University Melayu. That's why I keep on bringing my master weaver back to the gallery. I even introduced them to the top management at the university, hoping that she will be recognized by the Ministry of Human Resource and they will try to find how to certify her with the skill that she has as artisans, and she will be paid by daily if she would give workshop so that she can teach at the university, I mean teaching, and then at school as well. So there are some programs that we try to collaborate with school as well by having this one-stop learning center in Capitown, where we're actually going to collaborate with 5 secondary schools. So every time when they do their core curriculum activities, they can actually bring them to this center and learn about weaving instead of learning about how to build chairs and all this kind of stuff, which is not really in our tradition, you know. We have real artisans there, so why not learn this? But it's still in the process.
The point is that you were making that most of these people that are recognized in Japan, they're actually given an income. Like I know in the Philippines, they actually, a world treasure, will get an annual income from the government for being that. And it's different other countries are the same thing. They need to do something like that in Malaysia as well. If you recognize them as a cultural treasure, you should be paying them to be a cultural treasure. Because I know that in the Philippines, I can't remember the lady's name now, who makes so beautiful a bucket of cloths. She used that money, the income that she has per year, to set up workshops to train other people, weavers, to do that. And that's what the government should be doing. That's what I have to say now.
They give you a certificate, a trophy, and that's it.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Yeah.
Yes. Recently, they give $20,000.
Do you want?
I just found out from the one of the curator for the textile in Sarawak that there is one person has been recognized as living cultural heritage 2 years ago. She was given 30,000, but she's not sure whether she did receive the money or not. So just one off, it's like an award money. So she will not understand that that money is supposed for her to do good for the community, her own community, because she has been recognized and she is the person who's supposed to teach her local community, you know? Just one off. But I don't know whether it's true, yeah?
I was speaking to one of the gentlemen in Penang who is a carver of those big Chinese, you know, the black and gold.
Sorry, can you speak into the mic?
And he told me that he's also a living cultural treasure. And he told me that he was given a certain amount at the time, that one payment only. And I think he said it was 30,000. I can't remember exactly. So I was talking to him a couple of years ago. But I don't know whether everybody gets it, or did Bangi get 30,000 when she became the cultural treasure?
She was supposed to be living cultural treasure, but she didn't get any certification. Yeah. So she told me that she did not receive anything, except for the other lady. Yes.
Yeah. Penang, actually, they have this award for living heritage treasure, and they give, it's actually, I think it's supported by the government, and it's actually initiated by PHT, Penang Heritage Trust. And they give, I think, maybe a few years ago, and they give to a group of people. They actually get a very, not a lot of money, but every year they give them money until they actually eventually die. And they also have a center where they bring the craftsmen to teach the public, which is called Papa. But unfortunately, because not many young people want to learn the traditional craft. So they have a money bidding a master who is still teaching at Papa now. And also they have also, I think, a Mengguang weaving master. But they don't have actually that many students. And so it's going on, but it's not actually getting much students and all that. But they do give this award.
I think we have time for one last question, if there's anyone who wants to ask one last question. Yes, from you.
Sorry, I want to get back to batik, because I'm very interested in batik. I'm very impressed by the journey of how batik go from Jawa to Africa and all that. And I've also noticed, you know, of course, there are batik in China and also in Vietnam, there are batik as well. Maybe any of y'all has got any, are they come from Jawa as well? Is that?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. After all, batik is a relatively simple technique. And I think that probably people came to the same discovery in several parts of the world independently of each other. That if you put a molten wax on a surface, then simply it protects the surface. So of course, yes, batik is still practiced among the minority groups in China who also live in Vietnam and Laos, like the Hmong people or Miao groups, but it has been known for so many centuries, and it had nothing to do with Indonesia. Almost identical technique to Javanese batik, because it was molten wax hand-drawn, has been used in ancient Greece at least 2,400 years ago, because this is the oldest cloth which was decorated with that technique that was found. It was made in Greece. It has images of Greek gods, their name, and we know a number of such examples from ancient Greece or later from Coptic Egypt. So this technique was quite widespread in Mediterranean about 300-400 centuries BC, and also in the first centuries of AD. But what is very interesting, I spoke to some Chinese experts, Chinese textile historians, and they agree that as regards the technique of batik coming to China, which was very popular during the Tang Dynasty, it came through the Silk Route. But we usually think of a Silk Route as, well, textiles moving from China and other goods to Mediterranean area, Europe. But actually, there was also quite a lot of traffic going, goods going the other way back, and probably cotton textiles and batik, that was one of those, it was one of the groups of textiles and skills that came to China through Silk Route from Northern India or Central Asia. But I don't say that this is the technique which is used nowadays by minorities. No, no, it could be completely independent. I'm talking about the batik technique which was practiced in Tang China in the past.
Great, I think we've sort of run out of time. Thank you so much for being with us today. Please join me in thanking all the speakers for their really interesting sort of presentation.